Hey everyone, I'm Robert, and I'm a senior data scientist here at SAS. Something that's been on my mind recently is computer vision, and specifically object detection. Today, I'd like to talk to you about how to build a customized object detection model. Now, object detection is considerably different from something like image classification. With image classification, we're just predicting some probability of a class. But with object detection, we're not only predicting a probability of a class, but we're also predicting making several other predictions that correspond to the entities of interest, their spatial location. So is my hand here? Is it here? Is it over there? And so forth. So the output space is greatly expanded. And with this expansion of the output space comes an expansion of the error space. So now we don't have just a single error function. We've got a multi-loss error function where we have different pieces of the error function that correspond to each of the predicted outcomes. I'll show you today how to have your model focus in on one kind of a prediction versus another through lambda scalars that are incorporated in the error function. For example, if we'd like the model to focus in on the classification prediction, we could upweight that scalar in our code, which is upweighting that value in the error function, basically telling the model, focus in on classification. I'm also going to show you how to modify the model architecture, and we're going to do this by removing layers and replacing those layers with what are referred to as adaptation layers. And this is useful to mitigate transfer learning biases. Let's get started. So here I'm in SAS Studio, and the first few lines of code, the first 12 lines of code, are going to establish some libraries pointing SAS to the location of my data, as well as loading up some action sets. I'm going to run this code. And after the code runs, I'm going to navigate back to the code editor. This next set of code is used to create a macro variable that resolves to a list of variable names that correspond to the predicted variables. This is useful for just coding efficiency as we manipulate our data and our images. So I'm going to run this code, and I'll show you what this looks like in the results window. So notice we have a list of all of these different variable names. These are all of the predictions that we're making for a single case. So in this example, we're going to predict up to 37 entities within an image. I navigate back to the code, and I'm going to scroll down. This next set of code just uploads my data. The data that we're going to use in this example are images pulled from research papers, and these images contain compounds as well as arrows to gather, formulate a metabolic pathway. So these have been scraped from research papers, but we only have a limited number of research papers, so we've actually generated some synthetic data as well, which has compounds and arrows, the two entities we're really interested in, as well as noise. We've thrown some noise into these images to help us generalize. I navigate back to the code. Next, we're going to partition our data and shuffle the data per good practice. In the results window, you can see that our original data has about 16,204 images, of which the majority is going to our training data and some for our holdout or validation data. The next set of code is going to upload three different tables. One table represents the model architecture, and I'm actually going to print that table out and show it to you. The next table contains the weights of the model, and the last table contains the attributes of the weights. These are your batch normalization statistics. So I'm going to load up the model architecture, the weights, as well as the weight attributes. And I'm going to run this fetch action, which is going to print out the model architecture table. Here's the model architecture table. This table defines the architecture of the model. So if you'd like to go in and modify this model using something like a genetic algorithm or some other unique search method, you could modify values in this second to last column here, which changes the architecture. I navigate back to the code. In addition to changing that model architecture table, you could also use actions themselves to modify your deep learning model. The first action that I'm going to call is the remove layer action, which belongs to the deep learning action set. I'm going to remove the last layer of my tiny YOLO version 2 model. I navigate back to the code. Next, I'm going to add a series of convolution and batch normalization layers, as well as a few pooling layers, to my model. These are my adaptation layers. You see, my original pre-trained model was trained on images of cats and dogs and people in everyday life. But the data that I'm actually building this model for is significantly different, so the distributions themselves are different. So I'm including these adaptation layers to help my model adjust for this new data. Now, as I scroll down through the code, notice that I'm adding a new detection layer. And in this detection layer, I have several important properties that I'd like to highlight. First, we've got our anchor boxes, or good priors, that we're going to set for our predictions. And then notice that we've got this object scale and this prediction not an object scale and class scale and chord scale. These are those scalars that mathematically are typically represented by lambdas, just in your error, multi-loss error function. These are the scalars that you can change to have your model focus in on one type of a prediction versus another. Increasing one of these values will tell the model to focus in on that part of the prediction. Again, for example, if we wanted to ensure that the box is more close to the right size, we would increase this chord scale. If our model is calling all the dogs cats, or in this instance all the compounds arrows, and we want to fix that, we could increase the class scale. Remember, this is always a trade-off. Increasing one value is going to sacrifice the prediction accuracy of another, or could. So I'm going to run these add layer statements to add these adaptation layers to our model. There we go. You can see the number of rows is increasing, so we're adding more layers to that table, because here SAS is printing out just a summary of that architecture table. So we're adding more rows, which defines the model architecture. So that's one way to modify this pre-trained model. Let me show you another way. This next way is really cool. We're going to go into that model architecture table and change some of those values to change the architecture itself. For example, this first set of code is going to tell SAS to horizontally and vertically flip the images. So a mini batch comes in, and in the input layer, we're going to randomly sample from that mini batch and horizontally flip and vertically flip those images. Now, for something like object detection, we've got spatial location variables, predictions that we need to make. So in the labels, we need to correct those coordinates. It's usually 1 minus the horizontal and 1 minus the vertical if you're applying a horizontal and vertical flip. SAS does that for us behind the scenes, makes it easy, which is awesome. So I'm going to add in or modify my model architecture table, and you can see I'm applying here it's dropout to some layers. In the log, I'm provided a quick summary for each of those table actions that's updating the architecture table. Now we're ready to train our model. I'm going to run dltrain to train this object detection model, this tiny YOLO V2, on my data. So I'm going to run this dltrain, and I'm only going to train my model for 10 epochs. As the model trains, you'll notice that there is a summary produced in the log of the performance for each epoch. If you'd like to get more granular information printed to the log as your model trains, you can change the log level equals 2 property to some higher value. 3 is usually a good value if you'd like to see within each epoch the mini batch performance. 4 is going to give you a lot of granular information. I wouldn't go beyond 4. So for that first epoch, we can see the loss value, our intersection over union value. We'd like to see this value go up, and we'd like to see our loss value go down. We can also see those same corresponding values for our validation data. Now, as this model trains, I'm going to talk to you about the model itself. We're using a tiny YOLO V2, but there's better YOLO models out there or newer versions. So if you're using SAS, you have YOLO V1, YOLO V2, and then YOLO V5 available to you. SAS, we skipped 3 and 4. We skipped 3 because the improvements weren't all that great over V2. And version 5 is equivalent to version 4 for the most part. It's just, it runs a bit faster because it's a thinner model. So notice that we're at epoch 5, only 5 more epochs to go. Now that our model is finished, in the results, you can see the optimization history for our model. You're also provided a summary of the model itself, and this model has a large number of parameters. We have 55 million plus parameters. I navigate back to the code. Next, I'm going to take this model that I've trained along with the best weights, and I'm going to score our holdout data, or score inference the holdout data. After scoring or inferencing the data, I can see a summary of the prediction accuracy with regards to the multi-loss error function, as well as the average IOU detection for our holdout data. Next, I'm going to use the extract detected objects action to take our predictions and overlay them on the image, because it's a good idea to look at our predictions. After that, I'm going to save the images locally and view the images to see how well we've performed. So I'm going to run the remaining code. And here you can see our model is, well, not performing all that great. We're able to capture a few compounds, a couple of arrows, but a lot of improvement still remains. This one's actually not too bad. Compound, compound, arrow, compound, 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 arrow, arrow, compound. So this one actually did a pretty good job capturing all of the compounds and arrows. And again, you can tell this is synthetic data versus the real images. So today I've shown you how to create a customized object detection model. We looked at how to remove layers as well as add in adaptation layers to mitigate transfer learning biases. We highlighted those scalars for the multi-loss error function that exists in the code. We trained our model, scored new data, or scored our holdout data, and then looked at the predictions. And as we saw, we can improve these predictions probably by adjusting our model architecture, maybe going a YOLO V2 full size, or use YOLO V5, as well as let the model train further. Learn the data. Give it more time to learn the data. So I hope you liked today's video, and don't forget to check out the links below. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them below, and definitely subscribe for more content. Take care.